why we can't do it? People ain't giving. Why? We'll talk about that in a few minutes. Amen?
Amen.
Now, what's the takeaway? Read for me, everybody. If you don't mind. It's what? For maintaining the basic need. Y'all just want me to work hard tonight. Last night you were rolling with me. But tonight I'm dealing with some hard stuff and you have a hard time keeping up with me because you're trying to go ahead of me. What are you going to say next? Stay with me, y'all. Because I said before, every time you are a blessing to your pastor, the God, I said, will in turn bless you. Are you with me here?
Yes.
All right, stay, but don't make me work so hard. The provision for God's full-time worker should be equal with the world's full-time worker. Just like they get benefits, okay?
Yes.
They have insurance, medical, like whatever. So should your pastor. Now, so we understand basic needs. Whose responsibility is it?
Church.
Church's responsibility. Don't come talking about what a pastor be gonna give you a package of $60,000. Okay. Out of that, you pay for your housing, you get your insurance, medical, whatever you need, your basics. What does he have left? The maintenance plan is separate from his compensation. All right? You understand me? We'll go a little deep in a few minutes. Stay with me now. I know this is kind of far into the ears of many of us because we're so traditionally in mode. Okay? But this will liberate you. All right. The pastor's basic weekly wages. You ready, Rick? Let's go back up. I'm sorry. Let's look at verses 4 through 6 in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And let's read so I can kind of make sure it's clear. Set the stage for this thing. Paul is examining his defense for those who were saying he was not a legit apostle. And Paul said, I'm just as legit as the rest of them. He said, give you an answer for my defense. Let me start here. Do we not have a right to eat or drink? Remember that right, that word right actually means what? Power or authority?
Yes.
Do we not have the right to take along a believing wife, even as the rest of the apostles and the brothers of the Lord and Cephas? Or do not only Barnabas and I not have a right to refrain from working? Stop right there. He's dealing with the fact that should not my basic needs, just like Peter's basic needs, are being taken care of? Should I be able to take a believing wife with me? It's kind of funny. My good friend, Pastor Kevin, and I experienced the same thing. For vacation, our church sent us to Hong Kong. Matter of fact, this suit came from Hong Kong. And I loved it for them. I asked to go, they just sent us for vacation. So when we came back, I came back with all these bad suits on and, you know, shoes I had made, very cheap. So some of my members wanted to go back to Hong Kong. They said, Pastor, can you take us? I said, yeah, I'll take y'all. Let's go. Find a travel agent. Let's get some good prices. And so we went back, about 15 of them. We were having a ball. And somebody called long distance and talked to one of their friends and said, man, they here raising hell. They asking, did pastor's wife, did we pay for her ticket? And so they came and told me, I said, don't y'all worry about that, child. I don't enjoy yourself. So I got back. I had paid for my wife's ticket, okay? Had the receipt in my pocket. I got back. I went to preach that sermon. Called my financial director. I said, will you read this for the church? And she read it. I said, now who's sitting to his own? Pastor George Banks. I said, okay, thank you. Kind of took my time. I said, now let me tell y'all something. I got a word while we went home that somebody was saying who paid for Sister Banks' ticket? We shouldn't pay for hers twice. I got real close to my comrade. Let me tell y'all something. If you can't send her with me, or you can't pay for her when you send me, then don't send me. She's a part of the package. You don't pay for mine and not hers. If so, I'm not going. You're not going to insult her. And I kind of looked at the fella who I knew said, well, let me tell you something. I got real close. Don't you ever? Thank God the brother didn't come and apologize. But the fact is, don't you send the president to Florida and you say, well, you got to pay your own wife's ticket. That's a cheap church. A cheap church. All right. So, now we catch back up. What about his basic weekly wages? Here we go. Verses 7 through 13. You got it on your cell phones, your Bible? Sister Donna, read it for me. Metaphorically, don't try to silence him. Keep him hungry. Old folks say, keep him barefooted. Continue, please.
Does God take care for oxen? Or saith he it altogether for our sake? For our sake, no doubt, this is written, that he that ploweth should plow in hope, and that he that stretcheth in hope should be partaker of his hope.
Hold on 1 minute. That word hope pictures the idea of desiring something good. Watch this, with the expectation of obtaining it. With the expectation of what? Now, I don't preach for money. I don't teach for money. Okay? But that's how I make my living. That's how God rewards me for faithfulness, because I still live on earth. Still got to buy some beans and some collard greens when I get home. Still got to take care of Sister Banks. Amen. Are y'all with me here? So, at the end of this meeting, as well as I love my stepson, as well as I love him, been knowing him for years, when he get ready to take me to the airport, I don't need him to just shake my hand and say, thank you for coming. You did a good job. I'll give you a call. No, call me. Let me know you landed safely. No. There is an expectation predicated on hope. Because I've done the best I could. And God is going to reward me my wages through him. Yes. Now, he can be disobedient. That's on him. Are y'all with me? He's not going to be disobedient. I know where he lives. All right? Continue to read. I'm sorry.
If we have sown unto you spiritual things, is it a great thing if we shall reap your carnal things?
Circle it, because I'm coming back to it. Come on.
If others be partakers of this power over you, are not we rather? Nevertheless, we have not used this power, but suffer all things, lest we should hinder the gospel of Christ.
Pause right there for a minute. Paul is simply saying, we didn't choose to be recipients of your support, but we have the authority. And later on in the book of Philippians, you'll see what that church did, okay, contribute to his aid, and he received it. But to the Corinthian church, he said, no, we didn't participate. would make it just, you know, just like a, they enjoyed making tents. He did not want to hinder the gospel. He did not want to appear that he was just in it for monetary gain. Yeah. So he chose not to receive anything from the Corinthian church. But yet he had the authority or the right of the power to do so. That was Paul's choice.
Well.
You cannot base a case on his choice.
All right.
That's not your pastor's choice.
Right.
And it shouldn't be your choice.
Right.
Are y'all with me here?
Yeah.
And so in verse 13, he says what? Come on.
Now, one thing
I love about the Bible, and I love the teachings of Paul, he takes them right back to the Old Testament.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he reminds these people, he says, look, do you not know that they who minister about holy things live of the holy things? Those who partake of the altar share with what's brought to the altar? You with me?
Yeah.
And then he says in verse 14, read. Stop right there. Even so. Now that phrase, even so. So it is. Likewise. Just like it was then. The conditions may have changed. The culture may have changed. But he does not change. The ingredients may have changed.
Yeah.
Are y'all with me? We don't corn and green, I guess y'all don't, and peas, and put it in the back trunk of these pastors to compensate them with a different culture. We bring the Lord's tithes and offerings, and he's a partaker, a sharer of that. We're going to get to it. You see. I know you say, well, how does it? Just stay with me.
Yes.
I'm walking down this lane. But God does not change. I believe in this, and I know I'm on the right track. We ought to ask the question, what was God's original intent for tithing? Why do we still tithe? I'm going to answer in a few minutes. And that can help us out. Why does God still want me to bring the tithe? There are no Levites. Okay, we're not tithing our crops. Very few of us are farming. You don't tithe that unless you sell it and you tithe off the money you get for it. So there's a lot of things that we got wrapped in and we need to unravel, right? And so he says, even so has the Lord ordained or commanded what? They that what? Preach the gospel should do what? Get their living from the gospel.
Amen.
Does that mean that he has to every year ask for a raise and the trustee board goes back to the meeting and they decide how much he's going to make? How much he's worth? Does that mean the church votes every year to give him a raise? Remember now, would God leave him confused how he's going to be compensated? Depending on us? Come on now. Because if he's making more money than my husband, that's just too much money. That's not your business. Are you with me here?
Yes.
Now, don't y'all get mad at me. Stay with me. Because, you know, I've lived through this thing. I've been doing it for a long time. And I watch people when we start talking about how we compensate, how we care for our pastors we love. Like y'all want to attack me. All right. Now, according to these verses and other passages, the pastor's wages of weekly compensation, here it goes, or here it is, right? It's not going any place, should be done through individual giving of members.
All
right. Write that in. We call it pastor's care or pastor's support.
Yes.
Individual giving of the members. means it's the Holy Spirit who determines through you what you are to give to your pastor. Even if your pastor is not a participant of what we call pastoral sharing or caring or giving, you still have the responsibility to care for your pastor. Maybe your church has decided that this is how he's going to be compensated, but you as an individual still have responsibility.
Amen.
Amen.
Now I know this church does it.
Amen.
Mount Olive. They don't fuss and argue about stuff. They don't have to have no family meeting to see how much he's making. Or ask questions. That's your business. Nobody. He don't come and ask you, how much do you make on your job?
All right.
How much do you make on your job? How much do you make on your job? All right, I tell you what. Let's all get a form to the secretary. Okay? And every member has to put on that form your annual salary. Come on now, talk to me. I ain't giving nothing. That's my business. See, because if you did that, we can determine what the annual income is every year, predicated on how much you make. So if you're making $100,000 a year, what should be your tithe annually? At least $10,000. That's not including your offering. At least.
Over
10,000. Yes. So, individual giving of members. Now, 1 Corinthians 9:11-14 makes it clear. Now, can you turn to Numbers 18 for me?
Gotta walk this slow.
I'll be out in time. Well, preaching. Now, this is my philosophy of ministry. Whenever I'm studying something, I always go back to the first mentioning of it. Mm-hmm. When God first talks about it in his word. So in Numbers 18, that's the first time we discover a purpose for tithing. Then I progressively move through scripture toward a consummation to where it is what? Consummated, and it's made clear to us as New Testament people. You got me? You my reader, Sister Donald. Start with verse 20.
And the Lord spake unto Aaron, thou shalt have no inheritance in their land, neither shall thou have any part among them. I am thy part and thine inheritance among the children of Israel. And behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tenth in Israel for an inheritance, for their service which they serve, even the service of the tabernacle of congregation.
Literally, he gave all the tithes to the Levites, watch this, as their wages for serving in the temple.
Yes, sir.
That was their wages.
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes.
Not some, but all. Do you read that? Do you read that? Is that in your Bible? Is that on your cell phone? I see you still looking at it. So you don't want to believe it's that big. You look here. Is it there? Ain't nobody looked up at me yet. Y'all still looking down. Is it there in your Bible on your cell phone?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
Is it there? Don't mess with me. Is it there?
Yes.
Tell me if it's not there, because we need to turn that cell phone in. Some wrong app. You got the wrong Bible app. But is it there?
Yes.
Continue reading.
Neither must the children of Israel henceforth come nigh the tabernacle of the congregation, lest they bear sin and die.
That verse 24. Hold on, verse 24.
But the tithes of the children of Israel, which they offer as a heave offering unto the Lord, I have given to the Levites to inherit. Therefore, I have said unto them, among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance.
No inheritance, no portion of the land. The land was divided up among them. But they should not have any. They work for the Lord, just like your pastors work for him.
Yeah.
I keep telling you, they have one boss. You're not it. So you don't determine that word. You don't determine that compensation. God does, not you. Now, I stole this from the pastor of this church. See if he remembers. His job is to do what?
Feed and lead.
Your job is what?
Follow and support.
Swallow and fuck. I don't know y'all don't like that. No. Feed and what?
Lead.
And your job is to what?
Follow.
And nothing in between. No decision of how much he makes. Except the basic maintenance plan. That's your responsibility. But as far as his weekly salary, that comes through individual giving.
Amen.
Watch me now. Can't nobody tell this neighbor here how much to give to her pastor? Can't nobody tell this neighbor here what to give to her pastor? Are you with me?
Yes.
Unless Brother Tate said you're giving too much. And he's messing with the Holy Spirit.
Oh, yeah.
Are y'all with me? I was like,
yes.
Huh?
Yes.
So it's done on an individual basis, based upon the Holy Spirit leading you. Therefore, when it's time to have our family meet, nobody has to sit up and say, how much we paying the pastor now? You ain't paying him nothing. You didn't have to say, I'm requesting a 10% raise this year. Didn't we give you one last year? And the year before, you want to raise every year? Of course, there's going to be somebody who got mad at him who asked those kind of questions, amen? Am I making myself clear here?